Hello, it's Dan, the real estate guy, coming to you from the home office, and what we're going over today is comparable sales. Now, we're likely to do some very detailed videos where you're actually looking at my computer and watching what I do and how I do it. But as you've noticed so far, throughout all the core training, I like to sit right in this chair and go over the general concepts so that you can get a picture of the entire real estate procedures, all the way from the finding the properties all the way through the closing and then fix up and then the sale. If you gather all that information first in a general format, there'll be detailed videos, and we'll also be doing videos for your frequently asked questions. In other words, what pieces of the puzzle do you think you're missing? You email those to us, we'll be going over them, we'll be doing special videos to answer every aspect of what you need to know to get this done. But right now you're gathering and building your knowledge, you're giving your brain something to work with here, and today I want to just go over in very basic terms how I run comps, my comparable sales. Because I probably do it a little bit different than some people, I've just learned this over 25 years, this is what works for me. It's very rare for me to miss my numbers. It's very rare for me not to be able to get what I thought I could get for a property. It has happened a few times recently, and it's normally because of a market doing what I call taking stair steps down. In other words, when I bought the property, I had this information. By the time I got it fixed up, some of the pending sales, where you don't know their closed price yet, you only know their asking price, they could surprise you by having offers above full price. And that's always a wonderful, when you see they close higher than they were asking because of multiple offers, that's good information. Once in a while you'll get caught and people will have sold them a lot lower than the asking and you didn't know. You only had to go with what the sales were. You had some pendings, but you don't know what they got. And then you had the asking, which doesn't really make too much difference. They're just asking prices. They don't mean a lot. It just means that the way I look at asking prices is that how will I look compared to those? Can I look like the best transaction up there? That's what I'm looking for. So let's roll right into this. As you know, and I've mentioned many times, it's key to this business is knowing values, knowing what you think you can get for that property. That's why when you're new, if a property is difficult to comp, it's in a rural area and you're having trouble finding comparable sales, like type, we're going to call it like type, the most like the one you're thinking about buying, you might want to skip that one. I still skip some of those, and I have a lot of experience. From time to time, if it's a quality product, very well built, I think it has real appeal based on my 25 years of experience, I go to the property thinking like a buyer, you know, would I want that property? So you have to think sometimes. That takes experience. I can't teach experience, but you can learn from my experiences. All right, so the first thing I do, remember, I do have a license and I do have MLS. If you don't, you're going to be looking at Zillow, or you're going to be looking for other public ways to run comps. Sometimes in your area, you'll find out that the multiple listing service has a public area. They do for Sacramento area. I've never looked at it. I've had customers look at it and tell me about it. But I use, it's probably the same information with a little bit of restrictions is usually the way it goes. All right. So it's probably good information. So you want to look at that, and I'm going to give you the pieces of information that you're looking for. You can check your source to see if they have that information. All right, an example would be days on market. You know, if you just have a list of sales, but you don't know what they started at in price, whether they adjusted price, whether how long, you know, were they on the market, days on market. If you don't know that, it's a little bit, you know, the information is not as complete. So you're going to be looking for complete information in your area. What sources can you use? Some of your homework from earlier was to network with some realtors if you're not one. You know, find some folks that are willing to take the time to work with you based on the fact they already know that you're not a paycheck for them right away. But if they work with you and you become a team, you guys could do some volume business over the years. So you may have found someone that you kind of click with, you know, it works well with each other and you can get together on that, on the comps. So one of the things I do when I'm considering a property is, in our multiple listing, we have access to the county record. I like to look at the county record, print it out. It gives me the square footage, the age, the bedrooms, the bathrooms, all that stuff. Once in a while, there's a mistake on those. It's pretty rare, but it does happen, so you watch out for that. I then click on comps within the county records. For me, these are what I call county comps. In other words, some of these comps may not have gone through the multiple listing service. So when I run my multiple listing service comps, those won't be there. You know, if someone transferred a property without going through a realtor, they will be in the county comps. They just won't be in the multiple listing, right? And some of those sales aren't as valid. Maybe it's a family transfer and they gave each other a deal. You know, it's, you don't know. But it's information that I'm looking for. It's complete information. I'm trying to get a complete information package on that property. The way I like to run my comparable sales then, my comps, is I like to look at stuff that's the most like type. And this is what an appraiser does as well. But my first step is I run a radius search. That means that I get to put in the address of the subject property, and I'm telling the computer, give me everything within 1/4 mile. In most parts of town, that's tight enough to where when you find sales within 1/4 mile, they're probably similar to the house that you're looking at. You could be right on the edge of a neighborhood where, you know, the one you're looking at is built in 1985, and everything in that 1/4 mile that came up is to one side and it's 1965. That can happen. And you're gonna develop a sharp eye for looking for like type. Those really aren't like type, but they're in the same area. So you're gonna make some adjustments. You know, it's easy if you see that there's some sales closed from both of those groups within that 1/4 mile. You see some new homes sold and closed. You see some older ones sold and closed. You look at the dollar per square foot and see if there's an automatic difference. See if you can tell, you know, how much right away that they vary in value. It's really good to do. All right, after I run my 1/4 mile, and I should back up on that 1/4 mile. On the 1/4 mile, I'm looking for everything. You know, a lot of young folks in the business will look for a 3-bedroom, 2-bath when they're considering a 3-bedroom, 2-bath, for example. I leave mine open in that area. I'm looking for everything that transferred within that 1/4 mile. You see, if I limited to 3-bedroom, 2-bath, and it turns out that just for a little bit more money, you can get a 4-bedroom, 2-bath, and I didn't know it because I excluded the 4 bedrooms from my comparative market analysis, I wouldn't know that, hey, that buyer you thought was going to buy your property for the $199, for $209, he gets 4 bedrooms, right? You need to know that. You also need to know if they're smaller homes. Well, I'm looking in that 1/4 mile at everything that transferred. Now let's talk about that CMA, because I like to print then what's called a CMA, a comparative market analysis. It's going to start off at the top with a list of the active listings. Remember, I don't even look there at the beginning. Those are asking prices. I go right to the bottom of that CMA, to the solds. That's the most important part of your comparative market analysis. What sold and closed escrow? Right above that, you're going to have the pending sales. Those are important, but we'll get to that in a second. Those are also asking prices. So let's look back down at the solds. In the sold category, I'm looking at the lot size, for example, the year built, the bedrooms, the bathrooms. Sometimes within that 1/4 mile, the zip codes could be slightly different. In my area, let's say I just ran some this morning where the subject property address is Citrus Heights, but yet in the comps are some that are Fair Oaks. Fair Oaks is one of the more desirable areas. Citrus Heights can have both. It has some areas you don't want to be in, it has some nice areas. So automatically, you can look right at the sold values. Homes are almost the same size or within 1/4 mile of each other, and yet the ones with a Fair Oaks address pulled more dollar per square foot than the ones that had a Citrus Heights address. Some of them may have been just a block or two apart. So you have to consider that when you look at that CMA. All right. So I'm looking there, I'm trying to find the most like type, then I look at the most recent. I've got closing dates. You know, a lot of times an appraiser will look back 6 months. There was a time where they would only look 3 months because the market was changing so rapidly. I got in the habit of just looking back 3 months. If I don't have enough information, I'll go back 6 months. But if there's lots of comps, I'm going to go down the column and I'm going to mark anything that closed this month. I'm towards the end of a month here. Anything that closed this month is my best information. That means that the buyer voted with their dollars probably about 30 to 45 days ago, in some cases 60 days ago. That's what they thought the property was worth to them at the time. The reason I say 45 to 60 days is they've been in escrow all that time. Some of these escrows are dragging out, so they could have been in escrow a long time. But when it closed, I've got the close date right there. So if I've got 10 closings, but only 3 of them closed this month and 2 last month, I'm looking more at those than the ones that closed 2 months ago, 3 months ago, 5 months ago. But you also want to look at them all because, you know, you're looking for a trend. Did they get more 6 months ago or less, right? Did you find one of the same model? I love when I can find the same model in that quarter mile. Two or three of the same model really tells me what a consumer is voting for with his dollars. How much is he willing to pay? All right, so we'll take a good look at that. There's a lot more details, but let's roll on to the next point here. After I think I have established what my value would be dollar per square foot, you know, I think I know, especially if there's some of the same model. I then look up at the pending sales and see what's coming. You see, when the market was falling, the average, there'll be an average of each one of these categories, the average of the sales, let's say there were 120 a foot. And let's say I was counting on getting 118 a foot, somewhere in there, you know, times my square footage. That's just a good benchmark, something to use. So I'm looking at that, and then I look up at the pending, and I see, wow, everyone who's pending was asking less than that. Let's say they were average asking $105 a foot. Those are going to become comps. If they didn't get more than their asking price, they're also going to average less than the ones at the sale. Something I need to consider. Very important in a market that's going down. Our market fell like a rock for a couple of years. I did almost no transactions. It was just falling too fast. It was rough. You know, it was a rough time. But luckily, I have a lot of property that pay me every month from the 90s when I bought the 150 properties. Something you can set up from this down market. You should be able to set yourself up with some income for the rest of your life, right? So I had to take a break from the buying and selling. First time in, you know, over 20 years at that point. First time that of the 15 techniques, I wasn't getting any of them to work. First time. It's different than every boom and bust we've had so far. It's more dramatic, right? It went up far more and crashed. You know, to review, you probably heard it in another video, but to review, in my area in the 90s, they fell 24%. This time around, 50 to 60%, depending on the neighborhood. Maybe there's some that are only off 40%, but that's still a lot. It's a lot. It's different. But it's still a boom. It's still a bust. It's still full of opportunity for folks like you and I. So I look up at the pending, and I like it when I, let's say I've come up with 118 a foot is what I'm thinking of, and I look up and the pendings are also averaging, say, 120 a foot. Now I feel good about my number. I feel good about getting that number for that property. So then I say, okay, if it is 118 a foot times the square footage, let's say that number comes out to the 199. I look up and say, okay, if I'm offering this house, this square footage, this lot size, this year built, this number of bedrooms and bathrooms, and I was offering it for 199, how would I look up at the asking prices? So that's when I look at the top, and I look at the active for that quarter mile. If I was on the market at 199 with that product in good condition, actually I like to put it in turnkey condition, how would I look compared to the ones that are asking? Because after all, I want to be the next sale. You know, it'd be fine to sell anytime in the first 30 days on the market is a success. But let's say you reach a market where there's only two or three are going to sell per month. Well, I want to be the next one. So is my 199 going to look attractive? That's what I look up there for. That's why I look at the active. That's the only thing they really tell me, is what are people asking? Are they out of touch with the market? You know, I can look right at the average dollar per square foot for pending. I look down at the average dollar per square foot for the sold and closed. And I look up and some guy's asking way more than that. He's probably not going to escrow anytime soon, if at all. He's just out of the market. Fine. I can make them look silly by asking what they're selling for. It's an interesting concept, don't you think? All right, so after I've taken a hard look at that quarter mile CMA, that comparative market analysis, I then go back in my computer and I change the quarter mile to a mile. But I also go down to the square footage, which before I left it blank. Remember, I wanted everything. I wanted big houses, small houses, on the quarter mile. Once I get it, I can see everything transferring, everything selling. I'm then looking to see what am I most like, my most like type comps to get to my value. But I need to know, what can a consumer buy? Can he spend just a little more and get a lot more house? You know, or is there houses just smaller than mine that are dramatically lower that maybe he would go for over mine? I need to look at that, right, when I'm considering my price. Now, when I go to the mile, I'm now going a full mile. I'm taking into consideration the part of town that this things can change. But if I'm in an area where I think that mile is somewhat similar in product type, house type, year built, all that good stuff, I'm really looking now at that mile and I'm saying, what would a consumer have to pay to live within a mile of my subject property, the one I'm going to buy? What would he have to pay for a house that's plus or minus 100 square feet from mine? So if my square footage is 2,000, I'm going in my square foot range, I'm putting 1,900 to 2,100, plus or minus 100 square feet. I'm saying, hey, someone decided they want to live in this part of town, they want a home about this size. I'm not considering now the age, I will when I print my CMA, but right now I'm saying they just need a home in this area. You know, they've got four kids or whatever, they need this space. So what would they have to pay if they want to live in that, within 1 mile of that area? That CMA then, as I run those numbers and I print that out, now again, I'm shooting right to the bottom. I'm looking right at the sales. You know, are there, you know, everything there is going to be plus or minus 100 square feet of my property. Now, what happens if there aren't very many? There's one or two sales, there's one or two pending and one or two active. Probably that's not enough information. So I can go back in, I can revise that search. I can go back in and instead of going plus or minus 100 square feet, we can go 200 square feet. You'd like to have five or six in each category if you could. So I rerun that. But let's say the 1 mile plus or minus 100 gave me enough information. Again, I'm shooting to the bottom. I'm looking at the average. You know, what was the average dollar per square foot that the consumer had to pay to live in a home that was within 100 square feet of the one that I'm going to sell? All right. So once I have that number, let's say again it matches up. In the last example, in the quarter mile, it was 118. Let's say this thing comes out to 117, 119, somewhere in that range. It's confirming the information that I had in the quarter mile, which is what happens most of the time. Once in a while, it'll say, hey, if you have a bigger home, you're going to have to ask less per square footage, you know, obviously. If it's a tiny little house, they get a lot per square foot. So square foot, you know, dollar per square foot is just one little benchmark that we use. All right, just one. I find it to be a very accurate one. Appraisers will tell you they don't use dollar per square foot, but in my opinion, that's like saying when you go to the store and they sell grapes at so much a pound that you tell the store that you don't actually buy grapes by the pound. You know, dollar per square foot is a great benchmark. It's a great way to look at properties, values. You just have to make some adjustments. Once you know the averages, you make the adjustments. Is your property far newer, for example, than everything around it? I have one of those that's going on the market today, where most things are built in the 50s and 60s. And I have a home built in 1995 in a very desirable part of town. But I have a small lot and I'm near a busy street. So these are all things you have to consider when you're offering that product to the consumer. You know, what are their choices? What do I think is fair? What would make a win-win transaction? What would attract a buyer right away? Those are the things I'm considering as I'm running all my comps. So let's look at that. And we touched on a few of these things. I'm looking at that square footage. I'm looking at the age. I'm looking at the lot size. You know, appraisers like big lots. It's easier for them to give more value when the lot size is big, because that's the part of this whole thing you can't really build more of. You know, I'm building more land. Okay. So if you have a quarter acre lot and all your comps are a lot half that size, and you think you've got a quality product that you can get just a little more than the last guy, probably you can with that lot size, all right? But consider the area. Do consumers want big lots in that area, all right? Or do they want low maintenance? You have to think of those things. Here's another thing, cul-de-sacs. You know, the dead-end street, we like to call it a cul-de-sac here in California, very common, where the street comes to an end and has a big circle, and everybody, you know, they live on those circles. More value. People like those a little more than the street that gets you into the development, which I would call an ingress, egress street. Every morning, that's where everybody goes. They come out of these cul-de-sacs and they go to work, right? In the evening, they all come home. They come in that main street and go into those cul-de-sacs. So on the cul-de-sac is usually worth just a little bit more. So I take that in consideration. Same thing with we mentioned the through streets. Then I look at that street. Is it a big street with a big line down the middle and the nice shoulders, you know, indicating more flow? Some of the times they're smaller than that, but they put speed bumps in. I consider those things. Is the house sitting next to the stop sign so that, you know, everybody has to stop and then everybody accelerates? You know, you get to hear the acceleration every time. These are all little things that you'll pick up over the years, but you can pick them up from our videos now. Get years of experience in just weeks or months ahead. The one I told you about on the list today has got a busy side street. I prefer to have that. It's not real busy, but it's busy enough, right? I prefer to have the busy street on the side rather than in the front. And the particular one of the reasons I purchased this property, taking a chance on that busy side street, is just very well landscaped and buffered away from that street. There's a wall that the developer put in. It's covered with ivy, trees on both sides, right? A common area or lawn area. It just happens to be the entrance to this little development. And the side street is somewhat busy, but not real busy. So it's something I had to take into consideration. All right. So if that wasn't sitting on that side street, probably I would get $10,000 more for that house. Usually a very busy street, I either won't do it all, or I'll do it when the supply and demand is out of whack. I did one on a very busy boulevard, not too far from here, in the hot market that we had, the last hot market. Probably did that transaction around 2002 or 3, as I recall, and the market was moving up quickly. And I ended up making more profit than I thought I would. Not just because the market moved up, but because they were willing to ignore the busy street completely. As a matter of fact, here's a little lesson. I actually got a person that wanted the property because he wanted to be on a busy street. Now those buyers are very few and far between. Don't count on them. I don't do busy streets when the supply is big and the demand is small. But back then, huge demand. Everything that got listed pretty much got sold, right? And sometimes multiple offers over the price that you're asking. So I took a chance on a busy street. I was working with my two boys. Remember, it's a family business. I taught them that, hey, we wouldn't do this one in most markets, but we're going to give this one a shot. It looks like a good transaction for us, and it ended up being one of the best ones we did. Now, I mentioned the person that bought it wanted to be on a busy street. You're probably still wondering why? Well, one of those folks you've probably seen that likes to buy and sell things. And this particular guy likes to buy and sell boats. This property has a big concrete area in the front. It used to have a fence, but he took it down. And now every time I go by there, he still lives there, you know. I drive by it probably once a week. I have to go down that busy boulevard. And he always has a few boats out there for sale. So he's one of these guys, entrepreneurial type, that will go out and find, you know, see a boat sitting next to someone's house that's not in working order. He'll knock on the door, he'll buy that, and then he'll sell that. I can appreciate that. I buy and sell houses, right? This guy buys and sells boats. He buys a house from me. He's still living there. He's still doing his business. So that's rare, but it can happen. So back to the comps. When it's tough, we mentioned this before a little bit, but when it's tough to find comps, you know, sometimes you can't find any. You have to rely on your experience. So do me a favor, do yourself a favor. If you don't have that experience, don't do the deal. We like to say sometimes the best deal you do is the one you didn't do, right? So if you're not confident in what the market will pay for that property, you're better off not doing that transaction. You're better off passing, moving on to the next opportunity, all right? How about condos? You know, that's an interesting one. And a little trick that I've learned over the years is when you comp a condo, look at the resource that you're using for your comparable sales. If you have a button like I do for residential, and you have a button for then after you hit residential, I can hit single family home or one home on one lot. I can hit condo. I can hit halfplex. You know, I can do that stuff. Now, the trick I want to teach you is that when I run the condominium comps, I'm looking again, I do click on the condo. I run that CMA. But a little trick that I've learned over the years is you can go back and run it residential, meaning that you'll get houses in that quarter mile, giving you an idea of what a consumer could buy a house for. But that's not really the reason you did it that way. You did it that way because some realtors, when they list condominiums, they either put them in both areas, two listings, right? One in the condo area, one in residential. That way, they come up both ways. Or what I found recently one time on one of the ones I purchased that'll be going on the market today, as a matter of fact, when I purchased it, I ran the comps in the morning and there weren't any. There weren't any condo comps, none. But it was in Fair Oaks. I live in Fair Oaks. I was confident knowing what a consumer would pay. And I thought, I can get $125 for this property. All right? But then later that day, I ran the comps again, marking only residential, remembering the trick that some realtors will put them in the multiple listing, but not even put them in the condo area. They put it residential. They want everybody who searches residential to see this condo. So if you've got a young couple considering a home and they can't afford one, you know, it turns out they're out of their reach in that area, they can say, well, there's a nice condo. Would that work for you? You know, if they don't have pets, they don't have kids, and there's no plans of that in the near future, that might work for them. When they find out that they can live in Fair Oaks, but they need to live in a condo, they might choose that. So that's a clever thing that realtors will do when they list. So in this story, when I remember, I already guessed that someone will pay $125 for that particular model. When I ran residential, a comp comes up, same model, closed at $125, confirming that my idea of what someone would pay was real. Since then, another one closed for $132. While I was fixing up that property, actually, I even had it in escrow without going on the market, but that person didn't get approved on their loan just last week. You know, I had agreed to a win-win transaction with someone that found us without us going on the market, wanted to buy that property, and I agreed to a lower price, win-win. But it looks like they're not going to get their loan, so we'll be going on the regular market higher, quite a bit higher. So I wanted to help them win, it just didn't work out. So now we'll go on the market somewhere between that 125 and that 132. We'll probably go on at 129.9. See if we can go ahead and get what the last guy got, which is 132. If there's multiple buyers, they could come in over my asking price, or hope to get at least what that other one got, which is 125. All right. So that's the plan. I paid $86,000 for that property, so I'm going to do okay. It was one of the lightest fixers I've had in a long time. Cost me near nothing to get it ready for the market. All right, it was in great shape. So those are rare, but they do happen, and it's one of the exciting things of this business. All right, we already talked about the pending sale area, the active area, and the sold area, the solds being the most important. One thing I didn't mention was short sales. All right, now in our MLS, and you'll look at your source to see what they have, they list them separately. So we have the active properties, then we have the active short sales. Then we have active short sales contingent, meaning that, you know, they're still trying to get approval, right? They have to get approval from the lender to take your offer, so, or to close at least. But anyways, I don't really pay a lot of attention to short sales. I, in fact, look at short sales in my area. Could be different in your area, and if you're doing your homework like we suggested in the other videos, you already know the answer to this perhaps. But in my area, not very many of them get approved. Not very many of them close. And in fact, I've purchased some at auction while they thought they were going to get approval for a short sale that never happened. They had a buyer, but they just couldn't get it approved, and then I come along and just buy it, right? Cash, and just buy the property. So watch out for the short sales. Don't put a lot of weight on them. And know that when you look at your closed sales, anything that was bank owned, anything that was short sale is different than what you're going to offer. If you're doing what I'm doing, which is buying and selling some properties, when I go on the market, I can put right in my listing, this is not a short sale. Short sales are frustrating for agents. They're frustrating for the buyer. So they're relieved. Ah, another listing, but at least it's not short sale. Then it will also say not an REO. In my area, a lot of times when a buyer makes an offer on an REO, bank-owned property, they don't even get an answer. You know, they don't bother calling them back. You know, they put in the offer along with a few other people, and then I guess the guy who wins, you know, gets a call. But I've offered on some, and, you know, I've even offered on behalf of a buyer, you know, a friend of the family that wanted to buy one. We never heard anything. You know, when it went pending sale and we didn't get a phone call, we realized we didn't get it. So you stand out as a better listing when you're not REO and you're not short sale in my area. Check your area and see if it's the same thing. But in the comp topic here, just realize I don't pay a lot of attention to short sales. And when I see a low sale and I click on it and it's REO, I look at the pictures. You know, pictures make properties look better than they really do. So when it looks bad in pictures, it's bad. All right. You can read the comments and find out that maybe the kitchen was stripped. There was no appliances. So you're going to adjust your prices and comparable sales. You're looking at those comps. You're going to adjust what you think your value is based on how like type. You might find the same model in the same condition as the one that you're considering. Now you've got a real comp. All right. Everything else is a guess, but that's a real comp. You know, if you can offer the same product at the same price, it'll probably sell just like that last one. So remember, knowing the value is key. Knowing what it'll appraise for is important in our market. That falls under the industry problems right now. Watch that video. We're having a little trouble with appraisals. It's probably happening across America completely. There's ways to deal with that. Watch that video. And then I look at what will it sell for. You know, I know if it comps out at 118 a foot and I multiply that by my square footage, it comes out over what I consider to be a reasonable cutoff. So let's say, like I gave you the example, it came in at 206. Am I going to ask 204.9 or am I just going to go 199 and try to get this thing sold fast? I'm more likely to go with the 199.9, let somebody win, move on to the next transaction. Your homework. For this one, if you don't already have a source for comps, that's what you need to do. Whether you're working with a real estate agent, whether you're using a public source of some kind, or whether you have a license and you need to get yourself signed up for multiple listing, maybe you just have been inactive and now you're thinking about getting back in, get it all up and working. Because running comparable sales is key to this business, because you have to know. You know, if you're trying to buy something for less than what you can sell it for, you need to know what you think you can sell it for. All right? So find a source. Comp out some properties, you know, maybe the one you're living in, even if you don't own it, all right? If you own it, that's a little different. You're going to be a little biased, right? But comp that property you're living in right now and see what's going on. If you're living in an apartment, just find a condo nearby or find a house nearby, you know, jot down an address and just comp it out. You know, look for the information. See if you can figure out what it's worth, right? It's also very, very good to drive some of those comps. A lot of you are already kind of focused on an area. You know where the bread and butter homes are that we talked about in one of the other videos. You know where your target market is, perhaps. You know where the properties are that probably 50% of buyers would like. That's what you want to supply, right? Something that you can sell. Go drive some of those sales. We call that seeing the market. You're going to go out there, you've got a comp at 125, let's say, and you've got a comp at 175, and it's not too far away. Figure out why. Was it lot size? Is it age? Is it style of property? What's going on there? You know, is that area that much more desirable? You need to really get a feel for it. You know, when I look down, somebody gives me a lead on a property just based on the square footage and the zip code and the year that it was built, bedrooms and bathrooms, I'm already calculating a rough value. I can give a rough value on almost any property in this valley right now and usually hit it within $10,000. You know, I'm thinking, okay, that sounds like it's worth $199, and I comp it out, and sure enough, it is. When you have that level of being able to know the values quickly, you're then running comps to confirm that your guess on value is correct. Right? I rarely miss by more than 10 grand. I just know the areas enough. There'll be once in a while an area that will surprise me, but it's not that often. And now when it does surprise me, it stands out as a lesson. You know, I'll remember that. If I get another lead in that area, that's a hot little area. I can remember one case where I was getting ready for an auction property and I comped it and couldn't believe the comps, right? I thought, that's not right. And nothing goes that high in that area. I was generalizing, which you could do for a year or so. You could say all of Elk Grove was X dollars per square foot. But within Elk Grove, there's areas that are near man-made lakes where people will pay a lot more, right? This was one of those situations where it was not on the lake, but it was on the other end of that same street that had the highest comps. Instead of a lake, there was a park right next to it. Some of my competitors, when I bought that, thought I paid too much. In fact, a couple of them bet me. I think they gave me a side bet on what I could get for it, and I won those bets because I knew values. These guys are very experienced as well, but they just missed that one. They actually thought that I was running somebody else up and then going to let them have it. You know, wasn't the case. I knew the value, but I remember it surprising me when I comped it. And I actually ran them a second time thinking, what's going on here? Why is it more? When I mapped it, sometimes you'll need to do that, right? You run your comps, you've got your CMA, it's just addresses. There's no picture, right? Then go ahead and map those. If they vary a lot, If you can make a map of those, you can. If you can't make it at the source that you use, you can make that map at Google. Google Maps will let you do that up. Map it out. When you see a picture with all the comps on it, and you see that on the west side they're selling more than the east side, for example, you've got a clue now why that is. So your homework is to get out there and see the market a bit. Comp out some properties. Take that CMA with you into that neighborhood, and you drive the properties and say, okay, there it is. It was on the market 7 days. It sold quickly. It did this. It did that, right? Got that much per square foot. You pull around the corner, and you see the next one is a little bit doggy. It doesn't look good. Just closed. So you know they haven't done any work to it yet. So you're thinking, okay, that one got less per square footage. The street's not as desirable, perhaps. The house is not as desirable. It gives you a great idea of the market. And that's what you need to be doing right now, is learning the market. Really think about these comparable sales. Do it a lot. There's no wasted time here. You're going to comp a lot of properties as you look for properties. You're going to comp a lot of properties that you end up not buying. Remember, it's a numbers game. There's no wasted time here. You're going to learn on every one of those, every single one. You know, when I'm real busy buying lots of properties, I run comps on properties probably 15 to 20 properties a day. I'm pretty fast at it, but I do it because it keeps me up to speed. This last couple of years has been very challenging. Comps have been moving around all the time. I would get settled down and think that I know an area, and I would give a rough value based on that, and then I would, if I'm getting close to a deal on that property, I would go ahead and comp it out real tight and see what's going on, and sometimes that value is different than what I thought. You know, hopefully I'm within the 10 grand again, but they're changing. I basically have said for a couple of years, you know, retail value has been a moving target. At some point, the market will flatten out. It'll stay flat for years and years and years, and that'll make this part of the business a little bit easier, but you're always going to want to run those comps before you finally buy that property. You're always going to want to drive those comps. Remember, you know, what you do is risky, but you minimize the risk by doing the job right, by knowing the values. I still see people pay too much, and I wonder why. You know, I wonder how they interpreted their comps, you know, or did they run any, you know. But you have to be careful with this part of the business. So review this video if you need to. Watch in the future for what we call detail videos. Ask questions if you have them, and I'll see you on the next video.